Locomotion is a machine so familiar to us, we think we know all about it. And yet, as we delve further into its construction and its operation and its details, we find we know very little. So a couple of years ago, the National Railway Museum commissioned a survey and study into this engine, its operation and its archaeology. And it's great to have one of the authors of that survey here today to share with us some of those details. Now, it's my great pleasure to share Curator with a Camera today with Dr. Michael Bailey, one of the authors of the report. Michael, thanks ever so much for joining us today. I'm really looking forward to finding out more about this engine. But before we do that, could you put its position in context of what actually are we looking at?
The locomotive as we now see it has been familiar to us all since 1857, when it was taken out of service by the Stockton and Darlington Railway and placed on a plinth outside North Road Station in Darlington. It was the first locomotive ever to be displayed as an historic artefact. The locomotive, therefore, has gone down in history to us as looking just like this. As a result of the study that we've recently carried out, it transpires that this, in fact, it never actually operated in this form. It has been rebuilt on a number of occasions, and most recently in 1857, when it was being prepared for display. And as a result of that, what we've got is a replica engine incorporating a number of components from the locomotive in its last operating phase.
Let's talk about the engine itself then, the mechanics of what we have up here, which sometimes is rather uncharitably being described as a load of knitting needles. But again, Michael, we don't think that it began life with this, did we?
No. One of the main findings of our study, we had to solve the problem of why it was that on the opening day, the locomotive worked perfectly. It had no problems at all. It worked, as to use later day terminology, it worked straight out of the box. Now, that was great news, and it meant that it's gone down in history, the opening of the railway has gone down in history as being a fantastically successful day. Full marks. The second loco, when it arrived and didn't work. And they couldn't get it to work for several days, if not weeks. And therefore, we came to the conclusion, using as much of the evidence as possible, that in fact, locomotion did not start off with that knitting, as you called it.
The Fremantle gear, isn't it? the Fremantle Just in case, because people will pick me up on that and say, how dare you say it's knitting?
So we believe that therefore it started life without the Fremantle motion at all. In fact, it started life very much along the lines of the earlier Killingworth locomotives. In other words, with the crossheads, which convey the upward thrust and downward thrust of the piston and pass it down to the wheel for the motion there. The crossheads being guided by slide bars mounted just on either side of the cylinders. And some of the contemporary illustrations of the opening day, if you go in very close in onto the loco, appear to confirm that. It operated like that for 3 years until July of 1828. At this stage, Timothy Hackworth was keen to increase the heating surface of the boiler so that to create much more steam and therefore get much more work out of the locomotive. He had demonstrated that that approach, the success of that approach, using his new locomotive, the Royal George. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now, Royal George was obviously more had more steam available because of its return flue boiler, and therefore a return flue boiler was a distinct possibility for locomotion. But actually, Hackworth was trying to squeeze the lemon even more by perhaps having two return flues.
So therefore increasing the heating surface even further.
Even further. That of course meant that there's two chimneys at the rear of the locomotive. Who'd have thought it? Two chimneys at the return of the locomotive. Very odd looking machine.
I can imagine, yes.
But to have two flues to work, you needed two exhaust pipes. Mm-hmm. And that's the one thing which survives on this loco. And very few people have thought to ask why. There are two exhaust pipes to this day.
Yes.
which used to feed through the exhaust steam through to the chimney, to the two chimneys. And here we are talking in 2023 and saying, why has it got two exhaust pipes? That's the reason.
Absolutely brilliant. Perhaps the piece to finish our in-depth or more in-depth look at the loco is what we're actually standing by very clearly is actually the name itself. It's because it didn't begin its working life as Locomotion, did it? It wasn't known as Locomotion.
Not at all, no. When it was first delivered, it was the locomotive. And it had no name or number or anything. It was the locomotive. The crews, of course, had a nickname for it, and they called it Active. It wasn't until 1833 that they decided, well, the main lines that were developing then, like the Liverpool and Manchester Railway, they were all naming their locos rather than numbering. And therefore, the Stockton and Darlington directors thought, well, we'd better do the same. But what we don't know for sure is in what form the name was applied to the boiler, except this tantalising thing that in the United States, of all places, in Baltimore, in the Museum of the Baltimore and Ohio Railroad, they have got the remains of two cast iron nameplates of Locomotion.
Amazing.
And they're trying to convince us that they were from this locomotive.
Yes.
They might have been, but we have not found the evidence to confirm that. What we have found, by an awful lot of research, is that a gentleman from Darlington emigrated to America in 1848, about the time that the nameplate might have gone missing.
Well, well.
And apparently it was his granddaughter who inherited those nameplates, or the remains of them, and she, in 1940, as late as 1940, donated them to the Baltimore and Ohio Railroad and said, these nameplates came off this locomotive.
Absolutely amazing. And I think what's one of the things that if you're watching this and you are in the US and you know any more of the story of the Locomotion nameplates at the Baltimore and Ohio Museum, please get in touch and let us know. This is not the be-all and end-all. Historical research never stops for ourselves, certainly, Michael.
That's
you and
right.
I, we're always got our,
exactly so.
Our eyes open and ears listening for something. But what a fantastic story in this engine has through the research that you and Peter have been able to bring to bear. So thank you ever so much for sharing a small insight into this engine with us today.
My pleasure.
Thanks for joining us today for Curator with a Camera with the amazing Locomotion. If you've enjoyed it, why not like, share, and subscribe so you don't miss out on future episodes. See you next time.